The Philippine House of Representatives has passed a bill that seeks to gradually phase out the production, sale, and use of single-use plastics. Within 4 years, lawmakers want to be able to eliminate items like plastic tableware, film wrap, sachets, as well as styrofoam containers. This in a bid to protect the environment from hazards posed by plastic pollution and to prolong the service life of sanitary landfills. For her take on this, we are joined by Marian Ledesma. She's a zero waste campaigner of Greenpeace Philippines. Good morning, Ms. Marian. Thank you for joining us.
Morning. Thank you for having me, Nikki.
All right. So first off, House Speaker Lord Alan Velasco, one of the principal authors of the measure, said last Thursday, quote, "The time is ripe for the Philippines to enact measures seeking to gradually phase out the production and use of single-use plastic." So why now? How much of an impact to our environment is a pandemic that we are facing right now?
Yes, it's actually a combination of several different factors why this law is so urgent. It's because we already have a rising trend of plastic production and usage globally, and it's not just here in the Philippines. And what the pandemic has done is that it's exacerbated the amount of plastic waste that's being produced because all of these medical waste and also our dependence on e-commerce has resulted in more and more single-use plastics being used on a daily basis. And with this ban, we're really seeing how the House of Representatives is recognizing the need and urgency to address plastic pollution crisis. We do need a law like this, but it has to be one that phases out the use and production of single-use plastics without any harmful practices such as waste incineration and offsetting plastic production with co-processing or using plastic waste as an alternative fuel. And those provisions are currently in the House bill that has been passed. So what we would like to see is a more solid and concrete law that would respond to the plastic pollution crisis, but at the same time not create any new problems for the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. And Ms. Marian, we know that the ban is not immediate. The bill seeks to mandate within a year of enactment into law, right? But this will halt the production, importation, sale, distribution, provision, and use of single-use plastic. These include drinking straws, stirrers, plastic sticks, confetti, and packaging. What efforts by your group are currently in place to support this?
So Greenpeace isn't all just about the ban. We're also about looking at alternative solutions that will complement the transition or the phase out of single-use plastic. And what we're doing is that when we lobby for bans, we also want to have proactive solutions that can be taken on by industries and the communities. We want to make sure that people who rely on single-use plastics aren't left behind in this phase out. And an example of that would be the introduction of alternative delivery systems such as refill and reuse. So these systems you've already seen in zero waste stores, but we'd also like to develop business models that cater to low income groups and also urban communities, and specifically for community based stores like sari-sari stores. Mostly we see zero waste stores and all of these reuse systems in the malls. And we want to make these solutions to the plastic pollution more accessible and affordable for Filipino communities, especially those that rely on single-use plastics or disposable plastics like sachets.
Mm-hmm. That's good to know. And what are the best alternatives to plastic? Because some consumers may be turned off from the greener alternative since it is a little costlier. What will food processors and restaurants use to package food from market for storage, freezing, presentation?
There's misconception that plastic or going zero waste is anti-poor because it has been seen as a costlier alternative to single-use plastic, but really that's not the case. Decades ago, the Philippines already had these reusable practices in place with our thingy culture and not being dependent on single-use plastics, but actually using reusable containers. And if our corporations were to just adopt some of these practices again and go back to more reusable containers or packaging, we would be able to still deliver the goods we need while at the same time making sure that no waste is produced and at the same time, no greenhouse gas emissions or toxic emissions or also other environmental and health threats being made during the production stages. I think that's something that we really have to consider when we talk about plastic pollution, is that it's not just about the waste issue, but also the harms being produced during production. So these alternatives are already being tested in other countries by actually the same big brands that are now using single-use plastic here in the Philippines. So we have fast-moving consumer goods companies testing reuse and refill in grocery store chains. We also have them partnering up with entities that create reusable packaging that all they have to do is refill. And then once used, they return it back to the manufacturing for reuse and refilling.
Agreed. All right. But all of the executive departments will be implementing this law. But who and how should it be enforced best to make sure that the country is on track with the law's goals?
Well, it's really important that there's collective action around this law, and the different stakeholders do have to take part. So we can't just rely on our executive agencies or our legislators alone to address this problem. To implement this law fully, we need our local governments to take part and help in the enforcement. And most importantly, we need our business sector, our private sector, to really get involved and proactively work on the solutions and try to implement all of the alternatives to complement this phase out of single-use plastics.
And following this, the Senate counterpart measure filed by Senator Manny Pacquiao is actually still pending at the committee level. Following the bill's approval, how should the Senate respond with a version that promotes genuine solutions to plastic pollution?
When we want to address plastic pollution, the solutions we have to develop shouldn't create new problems. And aligned to its main objective of protecting Filipinos and our environment, the Senate version has to build on existing laws with safeguards for contamination, air quality, public health, instead of repealing protective measures we already have. And the Senate can craft a better bill that's concrete and doesn't have regulatory loopholes or provisions that can be potentially exploited by plastic producers, nor should it have all of these practices that create threats to our climate, our health, also our natural resources that we rely on for food and jobs and water. The Senate version, it really needs to have also a more ambitious timeline. 1 year phase out for certain goods is good, but a 4 year phase out for the rest of the items identified in the bill will take too long and doesn't really reflect the urgency of the matter. And more importantly, the Senate version should have more focus on upstream solutions. So solutions that really address the extraction and manufacturing stages of plastic pollution by reducing the amount or cutting down the amount of plastic produced. And at the same time, looking at transitioning business to reuse systems.
Mm-hmm. Now, Ms. Marian, we know several bills on the regulation of single-use plastics have actually been filed in the Senate since 2019, and none have since moved beyond the committee level. What do you think is the reason behind this, and how much of an issue should our plastic pollution have on the elections 2022?
I think plastic pollution, alongside other environmental issues such as the climate emergency, really have to be addressed, not just by the Senate, but all of our policymakers and politicians. And I do see that the Senate has been postponing or delaying action on these bills, which have been filed for years now. What we really need to see is more dedication and determination to address these environmental issues. Now, I know that the Senate does have counterpart, another bill that deals with extended producer's responsibility, but and that's currently their focus right now. But I think that EPR, or extended producer's responsibility, isn't completely exclusive from a single-use plastic ban. They are mutually, they're complementary, and they're mutually beneficial. So one or the other doesn't need to be considered. It has, both of them have to be passed and done or implemented at the same time, so that they can do complementary measures as well as also facilitating different transitions from new economies.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us, Ms. Marian Ledesma of Greenpeace. You stay safe.
Thank you, and you stay safe too.